big jam. The Sodor engines were hoping that Sir Topham Hatt would send Vinnie back home, but instead, he's giving him one more chance, and everyone was very, very cross. "Horrible engines like Vinnie don't deserve second chances," huffed Henry.
"He's a disgrace to us all steam engines,"
wheezed Percy. "I have an idea," said James. "To make Vinnie leave Sholdor, we should all go on—"
"Don't you dare!
Nobody is going on strike," fumed Edward. "And may I remind you what happened last time when you went on strike?" "Exactly. Now listen to me. I know that Vinnie isn't the best engine to work with, but he's helping us out since Murdoch is at the works."
"But why couldn't Sir Topham Hatt get another engine to help us out?" asked James.
"Like Gator, I haven't seen him in years,"
peeped Percy.
"Or even Sam, he should have been at the Great Railway Show instead of Vinnie," said James.
"I know that both Gator and Sam are excellent workers, but they have their own work to do. And from what I've heard, Murdoch's repairs are nearly complete," said Edward.
"Hopefully you're right, Edward," said Henry, "since I don't have the energy to deal with this anymore."
Meanwhile, Vinnie couldn't stop thinking about what Sir Topham Hatt had said and what kind of punishment he would get once he'll return home.
I guess this is it for me," he said to himself. "Maybe I'll be left in my shed for years. Or I'll be put in a museum. Or I might be scrap."
For the first time in his life, Vinnie was worried. The next morning, Vinnie was feeling bored and alone. He wasn't alone for long when Sir Topham Hatt arrived and had a very sour look on his face.
"I telephoned your controller about your attitude. You can imagine how he's feeling right now."
"So, what's going to happen to me when I get back?"
asked Vinnie.
"He never told me," said Sir Topham Hatt. "So, can I trust that you'll be more respectful towards my engines?
"I won't cause any problems, sir. I'll be quiet as a... slug," said Vinnie.
"That's all that I need to hear."
In an instant, Sir Topham had turned and walked away. Vinnie was as good as his word. Each time he met another engine, he would keep his mouth shut. The other engines wouldn't talk to Vinnie. They just stare at him furiously. Vinnie wouldn't make any eye contact with the other engines either. Hours went by, and Vinnie didn't say a single word. He was starting to feel proud of himself. That didn't last long. Vinnie was about to take some logs to the sawmill when he saw James and Percy glaring at him.
"Oh, great," moaned James. "It's Vinnie the Vile."
Vinnie looked away and stayed silent.
"Vile by name, vile by nature," fumed Percy.
Vinnie bit his tongue. James was about to make another snarky comment, but was quickly interrupted.
"That will do, James."
"Edward," asked James, "when did you get here?"
"Just now. But I have to say I'm a little disappointed in you two."
"Us? Why?"
asked Percy.
"Because you two are trying to pick a fight with him, and yet he isn't doing anything wrong at the moment,"
scolded Edward. James and Percy couldn't think of anything to say. "James, Your passengers are waiting for you at Knapford. And Percy, I believe that you have a small goods train to take to the wharf. Both James and Percy hurried away. Then, Edward gave Vinnie a serious look. There was a feeling of nervousness starting to creep into Vinnie. "You've been awfully quiet today," said Edward. Yet again, Vinnie stayed silent.
"Come on," Edward scolded. "Speak up! What's going on?"
Vinnie let out a deep sigh.
"Since I'm in a big jam, I figured that if I keep my mouth shut, there won't be any problems," said Vinnie.
"Staying quiet isn't good enough, Vinnie. You need to own up to your actions, apologize, and make amends," explained Edward.
"It's too late," snapped Vinnie. "Even if I did, they won't trust me. My treatment of everyone is inhumane. It's over for me anyway. I'll be turned into a giant soup can when I return," he complained.
"Don't be ridiculous. You can always try, and it's never too late to apologize and make a brand new start. I hope you can take that into consideration." With that, Edward chuffed away.
A brand new beginning, Vinnie thought.
Later, Vinnie was in the siding, thinking about what Edward had said. While he was thinking, James sped by, pulling a long line of jam tankers.
"That's quite a long train," said Vinnie's driver. "Maybe we can go give him some help."
"I'm sure he'll be fine. If he does need help, one of his closest friends will help him."
But James was in trouble. He was halfway up a big hill, and his wheels spun round and round.
"Must keep going! Must keep going!" chuffed James.
And then disaster. A coupling broke, and the last five wagons raced down the hill.
"Bush my buffies!" cried James.
Further down the line, Vinnie was about to head back to his shed when he saw the runaway jam wagons. Then he heard a whistle. It was Henry. He was taking the express to Vickerstown Station. Vinnie knew that he must warn Henry. He blew his whistle.
"Just ignore him, Henry. Just ignore him," Henry said to himself.
"He's not stopping!
There's only one thing to do," said Vinnie.
He raced out of the siding and waited for the impact.
"What do you think you're doing?" bellowed Henry.
"Something heroic and stupid."
No one was hurt, but the wagons were all into pieces, and Vinnie was covered in raspberry jam. Henry was stunned.
You saved me. Thanks.
"You're quite welcome."
"So you're responsible for this mess? Why am I not surprised? He's also responsible for saving me."
James was speechless. Edward arrived with Sir Topham Hatt. Right away, Vinnie became very nervous.
I understand that you saved Henry and his passengers from a nasty accident, said Sir Topham Hatt.
Yes, sir. I know I'm in a big jam, but this is ridiculous, replied Vinnie.
Even though I'm still not happy about your attitude these past few days, I'm very pleased that you saved Henry. With that said, you'll be returning home tomorrow.
But I didn't do anything wrong.
I know. But Murdoch is fully repaired now.
Oh, I knew that.
Edward, would you take Vinnie to the washdown, please?
Yes, sir. As Edward was taking Vinnie to the washdown, Vinnie spoke up.
You know, before I head home tomorrow, I still have a lot of work to do.
Edward smiled. It was clear to him what Vinnie was trying to say. After Vinnie was cleaned up, he steamed off to apologize to every engine he had treated horribly. This, of course, was a huge shock for everyone. The next morning, Vinnie was waiting for his ship when Edward arrived.
I want to thank you, Edward. Your advice was, well, useful. I know I still have much to learn and have a lot of work to do back home, but maybe after a few years, and if I do return, I might be better than ever.
Glad to hear that, Vinnie.
Well, there's my ship. See you around, Edward.
Take care, Vinnie. Edward was heading back to Tidmouth when he spotted Henry and Philip.
I mean, he said he was sorry, but I'm not sure if I can forgive him just yet, said Philip.
Me too, said Henry. I want to forgive him, but I don't know. I really don't know.
It takes time to forgive one another, but if he does come back, you might be friends with him, said Edward. Henry and Philip were very doubtful, but Edward is certain that Vinnie will make a brand new start. I really hope Edward is right. Do you?